I'm happy, first of all, to be back in China after more than 1 year, and to follow up on the great legacy these Olympic Winter Games Beijing 2022 have left on China and on the international scene, and in particular winter sport. This is impressive to see, and it also gives the opportunity to travel to Hangzhou and Shanghai, and also to Kufu, and to enrich my experience with the Chinese people and China. Well, that's another expression of the great success of this truly exceptional Olympic Winter Games Beijing 2022, that it was not only a great success on the sport side, on the legacy side, but also on the financial side. And therefore, you know, we are very happy to donate our share of the profit to China, to contribute, to even strengthen this legacy, which we can already see living here in China. I will be in Hangzhou for the Asian Games because the Asian Games have a very special place in the Olympic movement and a great tradition. And so I'm really looking forward to these games and to see the great Asian athletes getting ready for Paris 2024. Candidature from China is always most welcome, but right now, you know, we are have already allocated the hosts until 2032, so there China has still some time to think about the next candidature, because this would be about 36. But I'm very sure and really looking forward to many major international sports events taking place in China in the coming years. You know, there is still some time to go. You know, we are now 13 years ahead of these games, and we have already a two-digit number of interested National Olympic Committees or regions who want to organize these games in 2036. I think this will happen next year. By then we will have a clearer picture on the overall impact of climate change and the other challenges facing winter sport, because of all the different challenges. We have already been mentioning the climate change, but this is going further, and it's about the program of the games, the format of the games. There are indeed a kind of rotation system is under consideration, but it's too early to say whether it will happen or and in which way it will happen. Our approach to e-sport is with a priority to the virtual sports, meaning real e-sports where there is physical activity, cycling, rowing. In the meantime, you have even Taekwondo in e-form, and a number of other sports. Because the physical activity of these athletes there is on the same level like for the athlete in the traditional sport. You know, whether you're doing a leg of the Tour de France on your bicycle at home, or whether you do it really, the physical activity is the same and the challenges. Then we have a second area where it's about games which are being played according to the rules of international sports federations. Let's take the NBA, a game, basketball, or similar ones. And then we have the third category, which is about the e-games as such. We think we have something to offer to the elite gamers because they are facing, in some respects, the same challenges like athletes in traditional sports. They realize more and more that in order to compete at this high level, that they need the physical fitness. And they realize that they need to do something for their mental health. And there we are very open to exchange opinion, to give our expertise and to put it at their disposal. Also to inspire them with our values and inspire them with the need to be physically active so that they can be really having a healthy lifestyle. When it comes to the games, there is a very clear red line, however. This means that every game, every e-game, which is contradictory to the Olympic values, you know, like killer games or games which are discriminatory, there are an absolute taboo for the Olympic movement. Now we are undertaking all the efforts to accomplish the mission of the Olympic movement by having athletes with Russian or Belarusian passports back into the international competitions. There we are in a very close cooperation and exchange with the international federations, who at this moment are responsible for running their competitions. And we hope very much that this the mission then can be accomplished under the conditions which have been established. It means that the athletes from these two countries must take part as a neutral status, but there we need our time now to see how these recommendations are accepted and how they are respected. And once we have a clearer picture on this, then the time has come to decide about the Olympic Games Paris. I don't see a real boycott decision at the discussion at this moment. I think there we are a step further. That there are different opinions about the participation of athletes from Russia or Belarus, but the overall risk about the politicization is there, and you see, you know, statements of governments who want to decide on who can participate in Olympic Games or in international sports competitions and who not. And there, you know, we have to be very firm that these decisions have to be taken by the responsible sports organizations and that these decisions have to be based on sporting merits but not on political positions of a government. But again, I see, you know, that the governments, it's their right to express their position, but that they also realize that any kind of the boycott would only punish their own athletes and would deprive their people to be proud of their athletes, their Olympic performances.